Welcome back to GSS 2021. I'm John Paul Greemer from Tsinghua's Office of International Affairs, and I'll be moderating this masterclass on positive psychology for the post-pandemic era to be delivered by Professor Peng Kaiping. The COVID-19 pandemic represents a massive global health crisis. Because the crisis requires large-scale behavioral changes and poses significant psychological burdens on individuals, insights from positive psychology are critical for dealing with the post-pandemic era. This masterclass will cover the significant psychological assistance work conducted by Chinese psychologists to help medical professionals and people in need to cope with pandemic-related stress. Several important research developments in the field of positive psychology will be reviewed, and finally, some general tips and suggestions will be shared to enhance people's mood and well-being. Our distinguished speaker for this masterclass is a professor of psychology and dean of the School of Social Sciences at Tsinghua University. He is the founder of the psychology department of Tsinghua University, the Happiness Technology Lab, and the Chinese Association of Positive Psychology. He received his PhD in social psychology from the University of Michigan in 1997 and then joined the Faculty of Psychology Department of University of California at Berkeley. He's published 12 books and more than 400 articles and essays on cultural, social, and positive psychology. He's won the titles of Top 10 Best Teachers of China in 2015, the Person of the Year in Health Professionals in 2016, and is the world's most cited Chinese psychologist since 2015. Let's welcome Professor Peng.
Good morning. Thank you so much for such a glowing introduction. It's been happy to be back. I gave a talk last year for the summer school. It's very happy to come back to talk about the positive psychology for the post-pandemic era. My name is Kaiping Peng. If you have any difficulty to pronounce my name, just to remember how to play ping pong. So it's a Kai ping pong. I'm very close to ping pong. The topic is very much about how to deal with stress in everyday life. This COVID-19 global pandemic has caused a lot of troubles for ordinary people and also for the governments in various countries. Has probably already left a deep and permanent marker in human history. And its political, economic, and social, cultural impact are still yet to be understood. But the psychological impact is pretty much for sure. We now know that it's become the source of stress for almost everybody. How to deal with it? How to utilize the psychological science to help us deal with stress caused by pandemic and also related policies, related behavior and social life change are the focus of my presentation today. I'm going to give these lectures in two parts. First part, I will share you some insight from positive psychology, why it's very important for everybody to know a little bit about the positive psychology. The second part is about the tips and the practice you guys can do, can share, can practice at home. So why positive psychology? This is the first question. I would like to talk a little bit about it in the very beginning. We all know that we humans encounter all kinds of stress in daily life. This stress could come from career, your job, your study, exam, or relationship, like your relationship with your boyfriends, girlfriends, or parents, right? It could also come from health-related issues, like this pandemic, or other kind of health issues. Could come from almost every part of human life. Because of this kind of stress, we have different responses towards this kind of stress. You could have a fear, anger, suspicion, resentment. You could also have a so-called happiness, the authentic kind, because people have a totally different response to those kind of stress. So this kind of stress are natural. We have to admit that. It's a part of a result of human evolutions. because during the long process of human evolution, we encountered all kinds of challenge, all kinds of problems, all kinds of risk in all human histories. Because of those stress, we develop a certain mechanism to encounter, to fight, to respond to those kinds of stress. Particularly the three parts of our bodies are designed to fight this kind of stress. One is the hypothalamus. The second is the pituitary gland. And the third is the adrenal gland. Because of the stress, and those three parts will release certain kind of hormones to prepare us to fight or flight. That preparations could come from, for example, blood circulations or heavy breaths, or enhance your body and the bone strength to fight or flight. If you can win, you fight. If you cannot win, you run away. So that's pretty much the natural selections, two behaviors that can protect us from all kinds of risk. After we decided to those behaviors, then we go into this relaxation circles, so stress released. So all kinds of emotional responses you experience during this pandemic or during any kind of life stress, you all have the same response. Problem is that some people adapt this poor coping strategies. It's not very much natural selected, evolutionarily adaptive strategies. Instead, we overanalyze it. We think too much. Instead of to fight the problems, we think about the problems. For some reasons, this is advanced. This is pretty good human strategies. But if you overthinking those issues, then you will encounter problems. Professor Daniel Gilbert from Harvard University actually conducted this very interesting study almost 6 years ago. He gave 200 some students cell phones, basically ask people to call back if you experiencing certain kind of stress. Just tell us what you're doing at the moment. He was so surprised, almost half the people, when they encountered stress, instead of solve the problem, fight stress, they actually lying there, lay back. There's a popular term in China, it's called tangping, basically lay back. Not to solve the problems, but to think about the problems, reminiscing about those problems. And he found that kind of strategy is useless, helpless. It cannot help you to deal with the problems. Instead, sometimes it will increase, amplify the problems. So this is what we call poor coping strategies. Don't overanalyze the problems. Instead, you have to solve the problems. Some people, they don't even think. They just idolize them. They're lying there, sleeping, and probably drinking or doing all kinds of useless behaviors that cannot solve the problems. Some people use those addictive behaviors like alcohol, like marijuana, and those issues may temporarily relieve you from the stress, but it cannot solve problems. After getting sober, you realize the problem is still there. It's actually become worse. Some people using other kind of poor coping strategy, like hurting themselves, hurting other people, or suppress the emotional response. We find that all those strategies are not very adaptive, actually increase the problems even more. Then how to deal with the problems? We psychologists get inspiration from this very interesting study by Professor Daniel Wegerle. When Wegerle was a professor at the University of Virginia, he conducted this very famous, now famous experiment called the White Bear Experiment. He asked the students who taking his introductory to psychology class to think about a white bear. And that inspiration actually coming from the Russian writer Dostoevsky. In 1863, Dostoevsky published this very interesting book. The title of the book is called The Winter Notes of a Summer Impression. In this book, Dostoevsky mentioned this very interesting idea he experienced. The more you try to suppress your memory of a white bear, the stronger, the vivid the impression of the white bear coming back to your mind almost every minute. The more you fight, the more it comes back. So some people call that rebounding effects. So Professor Daniel Gilbert asked the students to suppress the memory of white bear. The more the student try, the more vivid the white bear become. So perhaps we get some idea from this experiments. All kind of psychological problems, all kind of psychological stress, the more you try to control, the more you try to fight, the more you try to suppress, it actually become stronger source of stress, cause bigger problems to you mentally and psychologically. So this is the white bear experiment inspiration. So is there any way we can actually forget this white bear? Is there anything we can do to suppress the white bear memories? You can try. You can actually discover. You have a way to deal with these issues, to suppress the white bear. The way is not to suppress. The way is to forget. The way to forget it is to by transform your memory or impression to other things. Instead of thinking this white bear, you can think about a flower, a smiling face of children, beautiful music, or even brown bear, right? You don't have to think about the white bear. You can think about the brown bear. Therefore, this white bear phenomenon disappears. Because of this idea, this inspiration, Professor Martin Seligman from University of Pennsylvania, who is now considered to be founding father of positive psychology, developed this interesting concept called positive psychology. He believed that in order to solve the human psychological problems, deal with the stress and other issues, the better way is to transform. The better way is to transcend all those issues, all those problems, to discover some talents you may already have during this human development process, during your efforts. You can actually have a better strategies to develop a sense of authentic happiness, the sense of a flourishing, sense of energy, vitalities. Discover and utilize those positive psychological strengths. You can deal all kinds of psychological issues and problems. Why this case? Professor Barbara Fitcherson, who graduated from UC Berkeley, once our students many years ago, now the president of International Association of Positive Psychology. In 2004, she published review articles analyzing over hundreds of psychological empirical studies on positive psychology, particularly on positive emotion. She discovered that positive mentalities, positive psychology, positive emotions can be very useful regeneration resource. What it means is called regeneration resource. It can help you to develop the resource you may never have, or even broaden the resource you already have, but it's not enough. So this theory is now called the build and the broaden theory of human positive emotions. He has a very evidence to prove that. He discovered that human physical strength, like the, you know, the way you walk and the way you're holding hands, can actually be helped by your mental positive experience. If you feel good at the moment, you realize that you have some strengths. For instance, you like to exercise, you walk much faster than before. If you feel depressed, you will feel that you simply have no strength to even get out the bed. So you can see the physical strength can be helped by your positive psychological experience. Your social resource can be built and also broadened by your positive experience. She found that if you feel happy, you like to call people, you like to talk to people, you like to interact with other people. If you feel stressed, you basically stay home. You don't want to see anybody, even your best friend. You don't want to even call your best friends because you feel depressed. So you can see your social relation can be helped by your positive emotions. Your social relation can be hurt by your negative emotions. Social relation very much determined by your experience, positive experience or negative experience at the moment. We also like the psychological mental resource. For instance, if you feel good, you have this determination to pursue your life goal. You like your self-identity. You like to be called as a Tsinghua student, or you'll be called by whatever the social categories you belong to because you feel good. But if you don't feel very good, you pretty much hate yourself, blame yourself, and you don't have this strength to pursue the goals you set for yourself. So your mental resource can be helped by positive emotion, can be hurt by negative emotions. She also finds that the intellectual resource can be helped by positive mental states. So if you feel good, if you feel very happy, you feel that you can think much faster, broader, and divergent. The creative thinkings can come if you have a very positive emotions. If you're very stressed, you find that your thought process is very slow and very narrow. That is why we see often when people feel angry, then they lost control. The reason they lost control is because they feel angry. If you're very happy, we don't see anybody lost control. Happy people are actually smarter people. They can deal with problems. Professor Emma Bell from Yale Psychology Department, she investigated 40 Nobel laureates, those people, so-called the brightest people in the world, the Nobel laureates in science. She discovered that the reasons those people who won Nobel Prize is actually they feel very good at the moment when they made this great discovery in science. So the reason they win Nobel Prize is because they are happy. The reason they win Nobel Prize is not because they are angry or depressed. So we find that the mounting evidence to suggest that they feel good is actually help you doing good. Talking about the Nobel Prize, there was a Nobel Prize by the name of Edmund Fels, and he won the Nobel Prize in economics many years ago. He had this very interesting discovery. Based on 40 years scientific study, he found that the wealth, the money coming from happiness, you may be surprised. He titled his book with this very interesting notion called mass flourishing. What is flourishing? Flourishing represents the mental states you feel elated, inspired, feel wonderful about yourself. So those people who can do good in business is because they're happy people. At least they present yourself very happy. People like happy people. Nobody likes doing business with people who are not very happy, who is angry, who is resentful, who is jealous, who is depressed. You don't want to talk to those people. So you like to talk to people who are happy, who are smiling. So he discovered that for a family, for a company, for a community, and for organizations, the more people feel good about themselves, the more likely they're going to generate a lot of money. Just a couple of months ago, he published his new book. The new book is even more close to positive psychology. The title of his new book is called Vitality. What is vitality? It's the sense that you feel that you have the strength, you have the energy to talk, to act, to do business, to interact with other people, to be very sure about yourself. That's what we call self-confidence. So his research pretty much prove our theory that happy people are successful people, unhappy people are people that need help. My advisor, Professor Christopher Peterson from Michigan, many years ago, I was his teaching assistant just to make a living, you know, teaching personality psychology. But 20 years ago, he switched his expertise from personality psychology to positive psychology, published first book on positive psychology.
It's called The Premiere of Positive Psychology. I strongly recommend you to read the first book, textbook in positive psychology. Before he passed away 4 years ago, before his passage, he published his collection of reflection and titled his book, Pursuit for Good Life. He tried to argue that in order to live a good life, you have to experience the positive psychological mental states. So those positive psychological mental states include four universally shared feelings people from everywhere actually enjoy. Number one is a sense of love. If you want to have a good life, you should have a sense of love. If you haven't loved anybody or anything, then life is not good. So the sense of love is very important. Second is a sense of playing. We live is not for the job. Many people misconstrue the purpose of life is doing job, is making contribution. It's actually the purpose of his life is to live, is to enjoy life. He find that that's universal sense that people share, that a happy life is a playful life. Number three, the elements of good life is to feel sense of service. In other words, is that the sense that you can help other people, empower other people, liberate other people, serve other people, makes people feel good. Why that's the case? Because of during the long process for human evolutions, we human actually live in the very miserable state. It's called a shortage. We don't have enough resource to share, to give to other people. Only those people who can give other people resource, the food, the service you can provide, other people likes you. You feel good about yourself. So this sense of usefulness that I can be very useful is actually very important for the sense of well-being. Professor Bandura from Stanford University actually called this sense of usefulness as the self-efficacy. So if you feel the self-efficacy, you can help other people, you can change other people's living condition, you feel good, you feel uplifting. So Professor Christopher Peterson find this is a universal sense of happiness. It doesn't include just the collective society. Even those very individualistic societies, they still like to endorse the value of helping others because everybody feel good about helping other people. The fourth element of a good life is what he called meanings. What is the meanings? Whenever we talk about meanings, some people have the habits to make this concept very abstract, very high level, even equalize the meaning to the calling of God. We psychologists don't believe that kind of a religious approach. Of course, you feel the calling. That's very important. That's your meanings. But you don't have to feel the call of the God. You could enjoy the meanings in everyday life. You walk near the water, you look at the water, you have the sense of inspiration and understanding. That's meanings. In Asian culture, that's called Zen. Zen is an Asian sense of meanings. So everybody can have a culture specific definition of meanings. But the meaning is very important. Life meanings is determined, is based on our understandings. So there's no pre-existence of meanings. Nobody born with a meaning or purpose. The meaning of purpose is very much shaped, discovered, and realized, accepted by you. So through the life process, you gradually develop the purpose of your life, and that discover, that sense of understanding is very critical for individual well-being. So you can see, in order to live a good life, you needed to understand little bit of positive psychology because it make your life better. Then how to be positive? We talk about the reasons. How to be positive? There's a very famous Chinese philosopher in history by the name of Wang Yangming. He has this very what I call the audacious claim that everyone is a saint. Obviously, we're not saints, right? We look around and we have small people, not short people, but mentally small. Or we have slow people, right? We have bad people. So why he said everyone is the same? Because he believed we all have a positive natures. The human natures, by definition, is good, it's positive. The problem is that we don't utilize our good natures. We sometimes even don't know we have good natures. So Wang Yangming actually said, if everybody can discover their own good natures and actually practice the good natures, then everybody can be saint. So that's his idea. Then what is a good nature? What is a human nature? And how to practice human natures? So what is a human nature? Different people, different scholars have a totally different definitions. Philosophers actually fight for centuries on this issue. What is a human nature? We psychologists are not philosophers. We don't fight, we don't argue. We just provide evidence. The evidence is coming from evolutionary process. So we find that all human natures must meet these two requirements Charles Darwin proposed 100 years ago. He believed that the human existence, all the human characteristics are natural results of natural selections. So natural selection select those human characteristics can be very adaptive for human survival, meaning that those characteristics, those traits, should be very good for all our survival, actually make us to live. If those characteristics make us live much shorter and dying young, then that characteristics will be gradually disappear, right? In evolutionary terms, called select out. So what is a select in? Must be those characteristics that are very beneficial to human survival. However, Charles Darwin actually proposed second evolutionary selection mechanism. It's called the sexual selection. The criterion for sexual selection is not about fittest, it's about most attractive. Peacock displayed the beautiful feathers. It's actually not very adaptive for a natural selection process. Just think about it. If a male peacock displayed the feather, then the predators can easily locate and discover and can chase you and kill you, right? But why male peacocks always display the beautiful feather? Because it can attract female peacock. So therefore, it has sexual selection advantage. So in humans, we discover many human characteristics are not just the results of natural selection, but also results of sexual selections. So in order to discover, to identify the human natures, we cannot mix human nature with animal instincts. Many people, whenever they talk about the human nature, they are not talking about the human nature. They're talking about the animal instincts we humans have. We as animals do have animal instincts. So all these negative human traits, like the evil spirits that we also have, that's the instinct to kill other people, we all have. That kind of instincts are animal instincts. Those are the common characteristics we humans shared with other animals. But the human natures, logically speaking, must be the characteristics differentiate the human from animals. So you really cannot mix human instinct with animal instincts. So what are those human instincts? One interesting way to discover the human instincts, to look at, to discover, to compare human characteristics with animal characteristics. So this is the research I did many years ago. We discovered that evolution actually select positive human traits because those are the traits separate the human from animals. Those are the traits differentiate the human from other animals. For instance, we like to talk. We can communicate. Other animals don't have this colorful, wonderful human language abilities. We like to think. Other animals don't have the neural cortex to think like humans. We have a sense of caring, loving. Other animals don't have it. We have the ability to cooperate. This is very important for human evolutions, because as individuals, we actually cannot fight those individual animals. You cannot fight the tiger. You cannot fight the lion by yourself. But if you work together with other people, we work as a team, we cooperate with each other, we can fight them, we can beat them. So you can see the secrets of human success is not by your individual effort, it's by the team effort, the efforts coming from collective efforts. So all this evolution, you may be surprised, actually select those positive, unique human traits. So those traits are the foundation of our positive psychology. So what is the discover human nature? It's actually to discover something unique to humans, to us. Loving, caring, cooperation, communicating, inspirations. And all those things are very unique human behaviors, human traits. And so positive psychology promote this idea. If you utilize the unique human nature, the positive inner strengths you may have, actually life could be enjoyable, life could be uplifting, life could be good, and life could be happy. Why? Let's give you one example. Professor Jerry Sherman and myself and many other people from Berkeley, I was a professor there many years ago, we made this very interesting discovery. The longest, oldest human neural pathway is called the vagus nerve. We used to think this vagus nerve only responsible for some physical human functions, like a breath and like actions, like digestions. Now we discover this vagus nerve system may be the first sign of a human sense of being humans, because it is longest, oldest neural pathways. So when we were not standing animals, like us right now, we were crawling on the ground like other animals, using our four legs, the vagus nerve was already there. But at that time, the vagus nerve is twisted, is suppressed. But since we're standing up, the vagus nerve released and smooths out and become uplifting. So now we have this experience of uplifting. It's actually the result of evolution. Because whenever we standing tall with our heads up, chest open, we actually feel wonderful and feel very uplifting. The secret is actually vagus nerves uplifting. Give you a couple example, life experience. You can do just as I do right now, I'm doing right now. We look at the beautiful pictures, you almost feel this urge to raise your head, right? Open your chest, and also probably will see uncomfortably, wow, bravo, wonderful. Did you notice the way you say wow, wonderful, how? It's actually with your head up, chest open, and your vagus nerve smooths out. If you try different, the opposite way, with your head down, and also put your two hands on your shoulder, suppress your vagus nerve, and then you try to say wow, bravo, or how, you will find it very difficult to do that. It's almost impossible to do that, because when we feel bad, we actually have the experience to suppress our vagus nerve. For example, if your finger been pinched by a needle, you feel the pain, you feel the urge to scream, how do you express your very unpleasant experience? You actually lower your head, suppress your vagus nerve, you will see ayo, right? The Chinese expression, ayo. Or in English, ouch. Nobody raised the head and opened the chest and smooth the vagus nerve and screaming, ayo, right? Nobody say that. Nobody say, ouch. It must be suppressed vagus nerve. So evolution already developed a certain human experience that are unique and not shared by other animal, other species. That is why those divine existence, those beautiful, wonderful, great sculptures, church, monuments, we have to raise our head, look up. The reason we do that, because we open up our weak nervous system, let us feel we are human being. So great philosopher Kant actually made this a very fascinating observation many years ago. And so basically, if you look up the sky and you feel certain sense of awe, the more you look at, the stronger your sense. In the meantime, you feel the sense of human morality. So that's very interesting observations. He didn't say why, because he was a philosopher. He already discovered this interesting phenomenon, but he didn't know the reasons. Now, by taking my class today, you realize the secrets. Why can't say that? Because when you look up the sky, you open up your vagus nerve system. When you open up your vagus nerve system, you feel the sense of a human evolution that makes you feel wonderful, feel good. So that is what the essence of Wang Yangming's teaching. If you practice the evolutionarily selected adaptive mechanisms like being humans, by discovering, utilizing human good natures, you can actually feel good, feel wonderful, uplifting, inspired by the experience, by the actions. So that is why we like to enjoy the sky, right? At night, the summer night right now, you like to enjoy staring, beautiful staring sky, because at that moment, your vagus nerve system open. You like to climb the mountain top, then you look at down at all kind of a mountain, the landscape, you feel the sense of an uplifting, the great experience you have at the moment. When you look at the oceans, right, when we ever look at the ocean, we feel great, we feel wonderful. That is because we all have this evolutionarily adapted human experience that is unique human experience. That experience coming from long history of evolution that made us to have this very adaptive, good characteristic that is called positivity. So we all have this positive nature. The question is how to utilize it. So my second part is some suggestions and tips for every one of you that can practice at home during this critical global health crisis. Even we now somehow controlled a little bit because of vaccine, but still we have to practice some protections, social distance practice. So during this very difficult time, how to live good life, how to enjoy happiness. So we positive psychologists provide certain tips. The first, we have to follow the science. Everybody can have individually idiosyncratic policies and skills and tips. You can do that, practice that at home. But as a psychologist, I would like to share with you some scientifically evidence-based practice and the tips. They all have to satisfy three conditions in order to feel good, in order to feel wonderful. Number one, try to somehow suppress negative emotional activities, because if you want to feel good, the first requirement is you cannot feel bad at the same time. So that's pretty much, you know, self-evident, because human psychological mechanism systems, just one system. We only have one neural system. We cannot do both at the same time. So we have to suppress negative experience. How to do that? I can teach you simple mechanism ways to do that. Number one, whenever you feel bad, angry, resentful, jealous, right, or very anxious and very tense, if you feel that emotion at the moment, there are simple ways to control the negative impulse. Number one is take deep breaths. Whenever we take deep breaths, it will calm us down a little bit. At least give you 3 chances to take deep breaths, or 3 times. take a deeper breath. So if someone say, you're so ugly, you feel very angry, your blood is circulating much faster, and you almost want to punch this person, at the moment, take deep breath, three times, at least three times. Because we find that whenever we take a deep breath, it calms us down. If you want to arouse yourself, get yourself agitated, then just, you know, just take, not take in, take out. That's why the Russian soldiers, when they try to kill the German Nazi soldiers, they have to scream. They have to scream very, very loud and long, like hula, right? You know, you have to get this breath out. Instead, if you want to calm yourself down, take the breath in slowly and very deep, three times. Very easy to control your negative impulse. Number two, you can actually smell something very beautiful, wonderful, elegant. So we human emotion response and all sense cause the emotional response have to go through the neural cortex, the frontal lobe. You have to analyze. But only the smells, they can generate the emotion response without going through the frontal lobe. It can generate emotions right away. So if you smell something that is great and wonderful, you actually feel good. So if you feel very depressed, upset, and you can smell some fragrance, or you can smell some flower. So there's an English expression, stop to smell the roses. And the reason they say that, because by smelling flowers, you feel wonderful, uplifting. Or you can do the Asian ways. You can burn a scent. The scent have this generate wonderful smiles, and you calm yourself down. That's why the Asian temples, they all have this beautiful, wonderful smells, because they know how to calm people down. And you know now, you know this technique now, you can do this at home. And you can take a shower, right? If you don't have a fragrant, you can don't have any like, you know, the scent, you can take a shower, use soap, clean yourself and smell yourself. Or if you have a baby, you can smell your baby. Actually, many mothers feel happiness by squeezing the baby, smell the baby, because it has this natural baby smell, body smell. So that's the simple way to control. Or you can write the diaries. We find that by writing diaries can release stress and unpleasantness. So writing can help you to deal with the stress. And you can sing, you can dance, you can exercise, you can run, or can do yoga or tai chi, all kinds of body movements. We find that can help you release the stress. So you can do all kinds of meditation practice, you know, all kinds. You can sing, you can drink in coffee, tea, it can help you. Not too much. We find the coffee, tea, if you drink too much, then you will have a result of like an alcohol, get you agitated, aroused. But if you drink small amount, it can calm you down a little bit. And so there are all ways that can help you. Some people like to eat. Not eat too much, eat a little bit can release your stress. But too much generate more stress, particularly for those people concerned about the weight issues. Besides of this controlling negative experience, we find that you have to generate happy emotional experience. How to generate a happy emotional experience? The four hormones are very critical, because those hormones can help us generate positive sense of emotions. Hormone number one is called dopamine. The dopamine is so-called reward chemicals, is rewarding hormones. Everything that you like to do is actually results of dopamines. Instead, you know, in return, if you want to feel good, and then you have to do things you like to do. So this is a very interesting logic. So in order to feel good, you have to do something you like to do. The reason you like to do it, because it makes you feel good. So it's a very interesting circulations. So what are the things that people like to do? There are huge individual differences. So I cannot recommend any specific one, because you have different strategies, different habits, different conditions. But at least the four things we find quite common people like to do. Number one, complicating a task at the moment, you celebrate your success. So enjoy your success. You pass the exams, then you enjoy the moment, at least for a while. Don't jump into preparation for next exam. It will destroy all the happiness you may have. And you play golf. If you finish one hole, enjoy the happiness, walking slowly towards next hole and play next round. Don't take this car, the cable, and rush to next hole. And therefore, you lost this opportunity to make yourself feel good. You finish a book, enjoy the happiness. You finish a class, enjoy the happiness. At least after finishing my class, at least you should give yourself 5 minutes break. Enjoy the moment by doing whatever you like to do. Just relax yourself a little bit. Don't jump into next class. So this is a way to help you to generate dopamine release. And we can also do other things like all kinds of experience people can have. Eating food, like cooking, anything that you like to do and can help you to generate dopamine release. The second very important chemicals can help us to generate a sense of happiness is called oxytocin. Oxytocin, we used to think, is only to help women to give birth to baby. Now we find that that's not true. The women, when they will give birth, they do need the help of oxytocin. But we males also have lots of oxytocin. Also, women that are not giving birth can also have lots of oxytocin. Obviously, oxytocin, the purpose of the function of oxytocin is not to help women to give birth. It must have other purpose, other functions. Now we know the function is to generate a sense of love. Whenever people feel love or being loved, and they have this oxytocin release, this is a research done by Professor Anna Sophia from Zurich University in Switzerland. He discovered that whenever people hug each other, they generate a sense of love and bondage. At the meantime, they release lots of oxytocin, suppress those negative memory, also generate sense of positivities. So hugging and playing with the baby and the kids and holding hands, we find that it can help you to generate this sense of positive emotions. And so I will give you all your homework to do tonight. Holding hands with your best friends for 5 minutes, then experience yourself, scan your body. Do you feel the warmness in your body? Or you feel chilly in your body? If you feel certain sense of warmness, like body temperature raise, congratulations, you still have this ability to release oxytocin. If you feel sense of a chilliness, then you have a problem with your friends. So you can do this exercise. That's called oxytocin release. Number three, a very important chemical can help us generate emotion of happiness or positive feelings. It's called serotonin. Michael Horton, who was a scientist who discovered the function of serotonin, can help us to lift us from any negative emotional state. It's called the emotion stabilizer or called the emotion, the mood change chemicals. He won Nobel Prize last year, not because of this research, but because of other research. In science, we always find that great people made a great contribution everywhere. So they really don't know, give him Nobel Prize for which contribution. But his contribution in psychology, I think, is very important. That's called the discovery of serotonin. Serotonin can improve our mood. Whenever you feel suppressed, depressed, then serotonin increase can help you. So how to increase your serotonin? We find that do things you can do well. So in order to generate the first we call the dopamine, you do things you like to do. In order to generate serotonin, you do things you're doing well. Whenever things you're doing well, you feel the sense of positivity or happiness. So what are the things you usually doing well? There are huge individual differences. Different people have different abilities, different talents in terms of doing things well. But there are something we find that everybody can doing well because there's no objective standard. Meditation, right? There's no standards say who's doing well than who, because you are doing your own meditation. You're sitting there doing meditation for 15 minutes. Nobody can judge you are doing well or not. So I strongly recommend you doing meditation because it can improve your mood and the well-being. That's called the meditation. Runnings, particularly doing this exercise on your own pace, not in this competition. So I don't necessarily encourage everybody to participate in sports, particularly professional competitive sports, because there are certain damage effects on people's mental health or well-being. But doing exercise by yourself on your own pace, you can feel this urge of happiness at the moment. So running can help you, right? There are other events you can do. Sun exposure, sun baths. So people lying on the beach, taking sun baths, it actually can generate a release of serotonin. That is why some people never understand why those people lying on the beach feel good, doing nothing, because it can actually make them feel good. Walking in nature, we find that walking in nature for 4 minutes, it can release serotonin, make people feel wonderful and feel very good. So doing things you're doing well, and that's pretty much it. Simple suggestions. You can make yourself feel good, release your stress. And there's number four elements that can make people doing well is actually endorphin, and that's painkillers. We find that doing exercise and is the best way to release endorphins, and watching comedies, and also eating dark chocolates or exercising, anything that can make you feel temporary pain, but immediately after pain, you feel this sense of happiness at the moment. So that's the endorphins. So how to do that? So there's another very interesting Chinese philosophical suggestion also coming from my lab, my research lab at Tsinghua University. We find that practicing five Buddhist teachings can also help you to improve your mood, release your stress and anxieties. And those five teachings are very simple. Number one, actually give people smiling face. Number two, give yourself bodily actions. Number three, talking to each other. Number four, mutual appreciations. Mindful practice. Number four is visual appreciation. So be more specific. I will do this very quickly, given this time limits. The smiling face, there's a very contagious happy smiling face, is called the Dixiang smile. This smile has unique features. And number one, you find that those people who are displaying Dixiang smile, the mouth open, the corner muscle raised, then uplifting the cheek muscles, and also will squeeze your eye corner muscles. Whenever you have these three facial muscles work together, you have this very contagious smiling face. Almost everybody, whenever they see this face, they cannot control the urge to smile. And why this smile called the Dixiang smile? Because it was discovered by this French physician by the name of Dixiang. In 1862, he discovered that if you have people to display these three facial muscle movements, you actually can find the person. A smile has this very contagious effect. So that's why Professor Paul Ekman labeled this specific smile called the Dixiang smiles. So let me give you a couple tests, because sometimes we humans don't display Dixiang smile because for various reasons, like the job requirements. And for those non-Dixiang smiles, you can actually discover they don't have this eye wrinkles. This is Professor Paul Ekman. Now he gave us two smiling faces. Which one is authentic, happy, smiling face. You probably guess right. B, right? The picture on the right, because you can see this eye wrinkle right there. This is a very famous actress by the name of Julie Roberts. Her picture was taken by photographers at the press conference. Now she has these two faces. Which one is authentic smile? The picture on the right, right? You can discover. So there's a picture, and there's a kid whose picture is very popular online right now. It's called a professional fake smile. And the reason the kids display professional fake smiles because you cannot detect the eye wrinkles. So we should have this very natural Dixiang smile, and you can make yourself happy and also make other people happy. So is this really work? Some people may say, is evidence to suggest this Dixiang smile can have this happy effects? Professor Doug Keltner from University of California, Berkeley, who used to be my colleague, now good friend, he took the pictures of this picture of this graduate class in, I think it's in 1960, I forgot exactly the date. Basically, 100 some student pictures he collected, analyzed those smiling faces. He discovered that half the students never smile or fake the smile, and half the students displayed the Dixiang smile. He went back to survey, to investigate. He found that those students, graduate students, who displayed Dixiang smiles can get married earlier than other people, like by age 27. Most of them married. And those people who didn't display Dixiang smile, they couldn't get married and marry late. So that's the effects of Dixiang smile. If you don't have the ability to smile, I will show you a simple technique. That is that you can practice what Professor Robert Suzanen have discovered. Put a pencil in your mouth and bite the pencil with your teeth, not your lips. Then look this mirror for 3 minutes. You almost feel you have to smile right there, right away. Anyway, so the happiness, the different ways you can do, different things you can practice. And because the time constraints, I would like to leave a time for questioning, question answer sections. But the point I want to make is that positive psychology is very useful. And I give you a brief introduction about the positive psychology. I also give you a brief introduction about the research and also the practice and the assistance we Happiness Technology Lab at Tsinghua University have provided to ordinary Chinese people. If you want to know more about our research, want to know more about our assistant programs, you can check online, you can check, talk to us more. Thank you very much. Enjoy the class. Enjoy the summer. Thanks.
Well, thanks, Professor Peng, for those insights. It's so enlightening to hear your views and practical tips on staying healthy and finding meaning in life. GSS participants have been really engaged with this topic, and this masterclass has generated a lot of discussion on Xue Tang X, and so many great questions have come through. Ruzbeh, a Tsinghua master's student from Iran, asks, do you believe that we could have full control over our state of emotion and psyche, or that we should simply accept that we as human beings are prone to ever-changing and dynamic emotions? Ruzbeh, I would highly appreciate your insight on this matter.
Very good, very insightful, thoughtful questions. It's also a philosophical question that debated by philosophers and scientists for centuries. In positive psychology, we have a theory called a set point. The set point actually defined that at least almost 30% of a human emotional experience can be controlled by individual intention, determination, skills. So if you really practice positive psychology, you control 30%. So you know my answer now. Why other part pretty much controlled or determined, not necessarily controlled, by your psychological, physiological conditions. So genetics actually control part of it. Also, your experience and control part of it. very important. Your living conditions, your environments, the context control another one third. So you can see that human actions, human determination can contribute one third, but the others pretty much determined by other factors. That's based on scientific research, not based on philosophical argument, because in philosophy, people either total control or no control whatsoever. We like to give a number. So 30% is my answer.
Thanks for that question, Rosba. We're now moving to Argentina. Eric from the University of Buenos Aires asks, do you think that new technologies such as AI and social media are working against the real sense of human happiness?
Very good question. That is the reason we set up this happiness technology lab. We believe that technology used to be very helpful to enhance our physical strength so we can move mountain, right? Because we have a machine, that's technology evolution. We can travel faster because the train, that's a machine, that's human technology. And then technology improve our mental strength, so computers can process information much faster. The next stage of human technology, I believe, is to help people feel better, feel good. So helping people physical strength, helping people mental strength, next helping people with well-being. So I believe that that's the future. But currently, we are still working slowly toward the goal. But I strongly believe, I have the confidence that technology can make people do bad things. But technology can also help people to do good things. So I'm on this positive part, believing technology can help us. But of course, in order to prevent technology to do bad things, I think we should have a certain moral principle. It's called the ethic of technology. Don't do bad things. That's number one requirement. Don't hurt human beings. That's very important requirements. But I believe we can do other directions.
We now have a combined question from Sir Ying Feng and Zhu Yuan. We love helping people, not only because we want to see them happy, but also because that helping makes us or gives us a sense of superiority. Is it possible to understand helping as an egocentric behavior?
Very good point. Actually, there are lots of research and also books and articles come out from that directions. So mountain evidence suggests that helping other people is a very evolutionarily adaptive human mechanisms. Those people who are able to help other people more likely to be helped by other people. Therefore, evolution select altruistic genes. This is actually an idea proposed by Professor Robert Travers. And Robert Travers actually believed that evolution never select selfish genes. Evolution actually select altruistic genes. We also find that helping make people feel good, feel wonderful. So there are lots of research done by Professor Elizabeth Dunn from British Columbia University in Canada, Vancouver. She discovered that actually give people a little bit of money, make you feel good for a long time. And give yourself a little bit of money actually doesn't improve your mood very much. But of course, if you get lots of money and you feel very good, and lots of money to other people, you feel not very good. But a small amount of money give to other people, make yourself feel good. So evidence to suggest that money can buy happiness, but it's for other people, not necessarily for yourself. And of course, the other study find that there's a so-called hidden gift of helping. So neuroscience research find the phenomenon called the helper's high. So when you help other people, your brain actually have an area light up, just like the reward you got for yourself. So pretty much the helper's high illustrate that humans can get happiness and well-being from altruistic behaviors. So evidence is very clear.
We've gone over time, but we've had so many great questions that we'll, if Professor Peng doesn't mind, we'll have time for one more question.
Sure, yeah, we can do that.
Colin Asper from the College of William and Mary asks, from an evolutionary social perspective, do you think that our minds are still designed to solve the problems of the past? what pushes us psychologically to progress? Is it the societal push for change, or is it deeper than that?
Very good question, and a very smart question. Actually, I never believed that evolution designed our brain to solve the problem of the past. I strongly believe that the evolution designed our brain to make predictions for the future. Because just think about many years ago, when someone encountered enemies who are throwing a stone to you, if you have the ability to predict where the stone will land it, then you have a better chance to survive. Because if the stone throws to you, you know the direction, you know the trajectory, you can step aside, you survive. If you don't have the ability to make a prediction, you will hit by the stone and killed by the stone. So basically, evolution select those people who have the ability to make a prediction about the future. I call that the forecasting ability. So forecasting is a very important human positive strength. We cannot live always in the past. We should live in the future. We have real evidence. We actually conduct a lot of research in China. We find that those people who are successful, who are healthy, who are rich, are more likely to talk about the future. Who are those people who always talk about the past? The people who actually have very few hours to live. Those people who are poor. Those people, I don't want to say loser, those people who are not very successful. They always reminiscent about the past. So thinking about the future, talking about the future, looking forward to the future, very important. Working for the future is actually positive human strengths. Those are evolutionarily selected human strengths. Thinking about the future is very helpful.
Thank you, Professor Peng. We would love to ask more questions, but unfortunately, we've run out of time. We'd like to thank Professor Peng for your illuminating insights on such a helpful topic. And we'd like to thank all of the GSS participants for their active engagement and great questions.
Thank you.
Just a reminder that we're now moving into Chinese cultural activities. We have Tsinghua bamboo slips, we have discovering Chinese characters, and we also have an introduction to Suzhou embroidery and Foshan paper cutting. This begins now, but feel free to view those in your own time, and we do hope that you enjoy that. So that that means that we're signing off from the third masterclass, and we look forward to seeing you at the next masterclass. Thank you.